His name is a metaphor for terror, violence, brutality. His onslaught against the downtrodden of London has rarely been equaled for savagery. He was Jack the Ripper, and some say he came from hell.
Beyond what is known lies an unexplored world of shadows and phantoms. A land that knows no limits of time or space. From the dawn of discovery to the nightfall of catastrophe. Journey to a universe of the unexplained, the unforeseen, the unbelievable. A place where myth and legend are law, superstition a science. A place beyond reality, where no question will go unanswered.
Time for our journey to begin.
The crimes are notorious. The criminal, unknown.
Our story takes place in two worlds, one of light, one of darkness.
The residents of London were recently brought to an intense state of alarm and terror by the most lurid crimes that human imagination could conceive and human fiend could perpetrate. Last night, September the 8th, police discovered the brutally cut body of Annie Chapman, believed to be the second victim of the Whitechapel murderer. She was found in Hanbury Street, and she had been most terribly mutilated. It is rumored that both victims were prostitutes, and police speculate that this might be a motive for these terrible killings. And tonight, in Whitechapel, fear walks the streets.
Frightened. Of course I'm frightened. I hope they hang the bloody bastards. Devil. Seems like the streets ain't safe for nobody these days. There's two of us, he's already cut to shreds, and the peelers, they just sit on their hands. And I'll tell you something else. You can bet your boot on it, if this was happening to some toffee-nosed tarts up west, they'd have had him dangling from a rope before you could say knife. I've walked over my grave.
But the worst was to lie ahead. Early morning of September 30th, two murders occurred within minutes of one another, as Long Liz Stride and Catherine Eddowes came face to face with whom? No one knew. And that mystery has baffled criminologists ever since.
Mm.
One of the only pieces of evidence was this chalked message found immediately after the double killings above a blood-soaked fragment from poor Catherine Edo's clothes. This vital clue was destroyed by the express orders of the chief of police, Sir Charles Warren. Warren claimed that Jouez referred to Jews, maintaining that he destroyed the evidence to prevent persecution of the local Jewish population. Why Warren refused to even allow a photographer to take a picture before rubbing out this message, no one knows. And there was more, even more bizarre evidence. Immediately after these murders, a community official received a grisly piece of correspondence, a letter that claimed credit for the murders. Also enclosed was a piece of human kidney. This letter was sent from hell. It was a puzzling 2-month interruption in the Ripper's ghastly work. But on November the 9th, he struck again. Unlike the other murders, Mary Kelly was killed in her room. After that, nothing. The murders ended as abruptly as they began. Who was Jack the Ripper? There's a new theory that points in an unexpected direction and suggests that Jack the Ripper may not have been a lone, deranged killer. In fact, it claims there may have been a method to the Ripper's madness.
I don't have to answer those questions, but I certainly have nothing to hide. You say Jack the Ripper was a whole crowd of killers, and I was among them. My apologies. It's such an absurd notion.
One of the most controversial theories about Jack the Ripper was presented in a book called Jack the Ripper, The Final Solution. The book's author was Stephen Knight, a BBC researcher acting on a tip from Scotland Yard. Mr. Knight has since died, but one of his fellow researchers is familiar with his rather fantastic theory.
I think that Jack the Ripper was more than one man. I think he was John Netley, a coachman. I think he was William Withy Gull, a physician, and possibly one other person. The theory is that that other person could be Walter Zickert. There were 5 women prostitutes who lived in very squalid circumstances in the East End, and they were murdered either to silence them or to stop them blackmailing. The reason that they were blackmailing is that the last victim, Mary Jane Kelly, had been a witness to a wedding, and the wedding itself would have been utterly disapproved of by Queen Victoria, the reigning monarch, simply because the royal person who was married, or allegedly married at that time, was himself to be the following king, the king following Edward VII. His name was Albert, the Duke of Clarence, known as Eddie. To say he married beneath him would be understating it. He married, apparently, a woman of a very poor Catholic background. Had the marriage been recognized, had the child been recognized, the child would have been brought up in a Catholic faith. The throne of England would have had to have gone to a Catholic monarch and would have upset the establishment of Britain and possibly led to revolution. I don't think Jack the Ripper was just one person.
According to the Stephen Knight theory, Jack the Ripper was 3 men working together. They traveled in a coach driven by John Netley. The murders were committed by the physician Gull, and it was Walter Sickert who enticed the victims to their doom.
Was I involved in the killings? Of course not. Were Netley and Gull? How can I speak for them? Although perhaps that writing on the wall says more than it appears.
What does the word Jouez mean? Well, according to the Knight theory, an explanation may be found in Masonic lore.
Thousands of years ago, certain betrayers within the Masons were executed, their throats cut from left to right, exactly the way the Ripper victims were found millennia later. The 3 betrayers were called Jouez. And according to Knight, two prominent Masons were Sir William Gull and Sir Charles Warren. Were the killings motivated by betrayal? Did the victims know each other?
So, do I look like someone who believes extortion should be answered with murder? Those poor women. Who can say they even knew one another, much less conspired together?
Could the Ripper victims have known one another? Annie Chapman and Liz Stride lived in the same building. Mary Nichols and Mary Kelly close nearby. Catherine Eddowes minutes away. They could easily have known one another.
The blackmailers were Mary Kelly, Annie Chapman, Long Liz Stride, Mary Nichols. Ripper victims 1, 2, 3, and 5. Catherine Eddowes was number 4. Where does she fit in? Dear, dear, there seems to be a hole in this marvelous plot.
Where does Catherine Eddowes fit in?
Someone walked over my grave. You are going to use my name, ain't you? My name's Kath. Kath Eddowes. But I go by the name of Kelly now since I live with my John. He's a lovely bloke. Regular gentleman he is. Most of the time.
Perhaps Catherine Eddowes was mistaken for Mary Kelly. And when the mistake was realized, the killer, or killers, returned one last time. The loose ends had been tidied up.
There are many loose ends in Stephen Knight's theory as well. There are those who say it is too tidy, that they have evidence that points to another man called Jack the Ripper. Jack the Ripper, whoever he was, has most certainly passed on to that special place reserved for murderers. London, he knew, has changed. But fascination with his bloody deeds has remained constant.
Today in London, Jack the Ripper has become a major tourist attraction.
Catherine Eddowes was found here in the early morning of the 30th of September, 1888. She was found just over here on the right-hand side, and she had the same fatal wounds as all the other victims. We know from the post-mortem that most definitely Jack the Ripper would have come up from behind, and with his right hand, he would have placed it over the victim's mouth, and with the left hand, cut their throat from right to left, from ear to ear, twice. Now, these were very deep, and without doubt, they caused the victim's death. He would then cut them from the throat down to the lower abdomen and disembowel them. But with Catherine Eddowes, he didn't stop there.
I want to go back and be able to tell everybody what I saw and what I heard and give them a little more information about Jack the Ripper. It is fascinating.
So repulsive and gory. It's just very interesting.
I think Jack the Ripper is probably the most fascinating historical murderer that we have. And because no one's ever been caught, that's even more fascinating. I think Jack the Ripper, everybody, no matter what age, knows about him or her.
Jack the Ripper, I believe, touches a nerve. A nerve that we can all recognize if any one of us ever, at any occasion, said, I would like to kill him or her or them. Then I think we can recognize who Jack the Ripper really was and is. He's all of us.
We forget the sordid brutality of the killing. And Jack the Ripper is now becoming like Dracula. He's becoming sort of like Robin Hood. He's now more fiction than fact, and he's moving more and more away from the reality. My purpose was to sort of push us back to the reality, because there is still time to get evidence. We're still near enough to be able to perhaps find things which may be lost in just a few years.
Donald Rumbelow has had 20 years' experience on the London police force. He has used his background to study the murders, and he discounts the conspiracy theory of Stephen Knight.
Stephen's theory is a very interesting one, but it is nonsense. When you look at his book, you find it sort of very skillfully put together. It's very convincing. But you will find, for instance, when you dissect it, that chapter one, he begins by saying, let us suppose that. And on that supposition, he builds a fact. So at the end of the book, you have got a very convincing portrayal and a very convincing argument of the great Freemason conspiracy, of the marriage of the Duke of Clarence, of the involvement of Sir William Gull, and of the painter Walter Sickert. But it is nonsense. The whole thing is nonsense. Perhaps it should be left to Joseph Sickert himself, who collaborated with Knight on the story initially. After Knight's book was published, Sickert denied, 2 years later, Sickert denied the whole story and said that he had made it up. It's nonsense. And it is a piece of fiction, and that's how, quite frankly, the Clarence theory should be treated, as a piece of fiction.
Donald Rumbelow believes a more persuasive case can be built against this man, Montague Druitt, a member of the upper classes who coincidentally committed suicide a few weeks after the last murder. But nobody can say for certain. Well, it seems that now we're back at the beginning. Still, there are facts that can guide us towards uncovering this murderer. We must just think carefully about what we've already heard and draw our own conclusions. What do we know about Jack the Ripper? That he seemed to hate prostitutes with an insanely violent passion. That he took an obscene pride in his work. That his identity remains unknown, confounding even the cleverest theorists.
He came out of the darkness 100 years ago. He killed in darkness. And he vanished in darkness. The figure of shadow, the figure of mystery. He slashed not only the throats of his victims, but the veil of hypocrisy that surrounded the middle and upper classes of his day, not only in England, but all over the world. With that knife, he penetrated the deepest secrets of our own being. And we recall him as Jack the Ripper.
Time has not answered several key questions. Why did the Ripper only kill prostitutes? And who wrote the Jewel message? And what does it mean? And why did the killing stop after Mary Kelly? Then there's the confession that Walter Sickert allegedly made to his son. Were those words ever uttered?
Like all of London, I was quite relieved when the murder ceased. When I no longer had to hear those cries for help. Those cries for all witnesses to step forward. If I knew anything, and I kept silent, then I would be well and truly damned.
Walter Sickert went to his grave in 1942. He took with him any secrets he possessed, if indeed he possessed any. And Jack the Ripper's identity still remains a mystery. No matter who or what Jack the Ripper was, he stands as an object lesson. For when people put aside their humanity for whatever reason, they become monsters. And no theorist has ever argued that Jack the Ripper was anything but that, a monster in human form. Jack the Ripper. Evil with a human face.
Secrets and Mysteries presents information based in part on theories and opinions, some of which are controversial. The producer's purpose is not to validate any side of an issue, but through the use of actualities and dramatic recreation, relate a possible answer, but not the only answer, to this material. Transportation to England for Secrets and Mysteries provided by British Caledonian Airways.
According to a recent poll taken in the United States, half of its population believed that the universe is inhabited by other intelligent life. The rest of the world cannot be far behind. The 1950s witnessed a sharp increase in the number of sightings all around the world, and with it, more and more evidence that something unusual was happening in our skies. Even the United States government took notice, beginning an official Air Force investigation called Project Blue Book. Their files soon overflowed with more than 12,000 sightings. These water beasts may well be the most ancient surviving inhabitants of our planet.
Did I see the monster? I don't know, but I do believe that, you know, I obviously saw some things, and nobody's been able to tell me what I saw. So I think I must have seen the monster.
Stonehenge. That place has become a metaphor for the magnificent, the unfathomable, and the mysterious.
I have the feeling that the people who built it had something very strongly in mind, maybe more than the astronomy and the worship. And I wish to goodness I knew what it was, and maybe I never will.
German scientist Wernher von Braun is considered to be the architect of America's space program. Von Braun and his team took the technology from the German V-2 rocket, which had been created for destruction, and applied it to the development of the chariots that would take man to new worlds.
There's never been an astronaut who got on a spacecraft, whether it was Mercury, Apollo, or even Shuttle, who didn't fully understand the risk involved and who wasn't willing to take them.
The only voyage of the Titanic was surrounded by bad luck that defies belief. Everything that could go wrong did go wrong. It was as if she was cursed. A curse, some say, began when she was launched.
He went up and he came back. He says, it's nothing much. They only struck an iceberg.
This magnificent object is a symbol of genius, of ambition, and of dedication, for it is believed to have taken 30 years to construct. And that construction is not the least of its miracles.
It stands as, you know, one of the most prominent monuments for its size and complexity and also its lack of information about it. To be able to plan and economically accomplish such a large feat for the pharaoh is extraordinary.
This is the Mark of Sasquatch, taken from a set of tracks that covered a 5-mile stretch of dense forest. The depth of each print indicates that whatever made it weighed 800 pounds. 800 pounds. And there's other, more dramatic evidence. On a hot afternoon in October, Roger Patterson and a friend were riding through some woods in Northern California. Suddenly, their horses shied. They looked ahead and saw something squatting by the creek. As the creature ambled away, Patterson took this film. Film that has been analyzed, debated, and contested ever since.